Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Jack Ashby from UCL Museums, and I'm here in my capacity as chair of the UCL Lunch Hour Lecture Committee to welcome you all and welcome our speaker, Professor John Sutherland. John is the Lord Northcliffe Professor Emeritus of Modern English Literature here at UCL, and he's written very many books and writes regularly for The Guardian and is editor of the Oxford Companion of Popular Fiction. His many distinctions include chairing the judging panel for the Man Booker Prize, and is one of the UCL academics to have their own Wikipedia page, which such a grasp of the modern particularly perfectly places him for today's talk, Dr. Dre, in the classroom. Before we begin, John, at John's request, we're going to have a sample of the material he'll be talking about today. So, Professor John Sutherland. Join me.
That's just the way it is.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Things things will never be the same. That's just the way it is. That's just the way it is. Things will never be the same. That's just the way it is. Oh yeah.
Some things will never change.
Some things do change. You'll have picked up the line there, you know, sort of. And although it ain't, although it seems heaven sent, we ain't ready to see a black president. Well, we do have one in America. POTUS is Barack Obama. But the penitentiary is still packed and it's filled with blacks. I chose that, I mean, it's also, I think, rather poignant. He did get the payback from some buck that he roughed up way back, rat-a-tat-tat. It's Tupac Shakur, of course, the brilliant leader of the, artistically brilliant leader of the West Coast School of Rap, murdered at the age of 25, younger than some of the people you'll see milling about in the campus outside. His great adversary, of course, one-time friend Biggie Smalls, the East Coast exponent of rap, also murdered at 25. There was a gang confrontation between these two. Now, I'll begin by, as it were, sort of making the statement on which my remarks will depend. I think that Tupac Shakur, less so Biggie Smalls, but Tupac Shakur and certain others, Ice Cube notably, are great poets in the American tradition, which was founded by Walt Whitman, Songs of Myself, Leaves of Grass, Free Verse. I don't think there's any kind of connection in a kind of literary sense. I think actually Shakur was well educated. Ice Cube particularly well had an MA in, I think, architectural studies. These were not, as they say, their mama didn't raise no fool. Now I became interested in rap. I'm obviously a pointy-headed professor who writes books about William Makepeace Thackeray and Anthony Trollope. But I came interested in rap because I spent 25 years of my career, now over, that's what emeritus means, in Los Angeles at a kind of a science institution where they believed in humanities, Caltech. When I went over there in the early 80s, I was aware, in fact, that there were things happening in the music scene. This was the period when, in fact, there was a lot of play for Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five, and that what is still now, I think, a classic record. You still hear it, the message. You know, so it's like a jungle. Sometimes it makes me wonder how I keep from going under. And there's that wonderful rippling sort of riff in the background, ding a ding a ding ding, you know. But I didn't really get interested in rap as something on my landscape until the early 90s with the Rodney King riots. What was it Tupac Shakur says in To Live and Die in L.A.? Get us pissed, we'll burn this place down. Well, they damn near did it in the aftermath of the Rodney King outrage. You remember the situation. What happened was that for years, L.A. had been run virtually as a police state by Daryl Gates, who was he was hard-nosed, old-school policeman of the kind that went right the way back in L.A., where they had traditions of summary justice, and he withheld his police. I guess, in fact, the mayor, who was an African-American, Tom Bradley, said he was outraged by the Rodney King riot when these five policemen beat into a pulp some luckless motorist, Rodney King, who'd happened to be, they claimed, driving at 110 miles an hour in a car which couldn't have done 25 with a good tailwind behind. But it was caught on video by a guy called Halliday, and then it went viral. And Bradley was outraged, and King was outraged against Bradley and withheld the police. So in fact, L.A. burned. About the same time, Ice-T released, or his group Body Count released a rap track called Cop Killer. I'll just actually You may know it. I got my 12-gauge sawed off. I got my headlights turned off. I'm about to bust some shots off. I'm about to dust some cops off. Police are hated. Charlton Heston, of all people, then the president of the NRA, got furious by this, and Warner Records, which had produced it, were boycotted. Protests were launched against them. Tipper Gore wanted X-rated stickers put on that kind of record. Ice-T, in a very icy way, said, "You know, you think I'm a gangster? You think David Bowie is an astronaut?" drawing on. And then, of course, to compound the joke, he went on to be Finn Tutuola in Law and Order after doing a detective in New Jack City, which was one of the black exploitation films. I got very interested in rap at that point, and I was reminded of a book which I read much earlier by Leroy Jones, later Amiri Baraka, renamed himself. But Leroy Jones wrote a book in the 60s called Blues People, Black Music in White America. Now, what Jones said was that, you know, the great, you could argue the only truly American art form, blues, and its spin-off jazz, originated in slavery, because in fact the slaves had nothing left to express themselves with. Their language was taken away, all their cultural heritage was stripped away, their families were broken down, they were atomized, they were chattels. But all they had left was the voice and the drum. And you know, that in fact was enough. Out of that came blues. There was also one of those happy, unhappy events, the American Civil War. After the American Civil War, there were a huge number of military marching bands. At that time, everyone went to war to the sound of music, Sousa, you know, da-da, da-da-da, that kind of stuff. And all those instruments, after demobilization, were left hanging around. In New Orleans, which was in the South, there was a huge number of brass instruments. So people like Louis Armstrong came along, and they could pick up a trumpet or a cornet, trombone if you were Kid Ory, clarinet if you were Johnny Dodds, for pennies, or for cents. So, I mean, if it hadn't been for the American Civil War, we would never have had potato head blues. So a million people died in that war in order to give us some... give us jazz. But the blues carried on. And the thing about blues is, I say, it is basic constituents music, the voice and the drum. Now, for years in LA, I loved driving the freeways by myself. You know, that Chuck Berry song about, you know, cruising along in my car, listen to the radio, no particular place to go. I loved that. I loved the freeways. The 134, the 201, I particularly like the Century Freeway, which in fact, if you know the film Speed, is the one in which Keanu Reeves and Sandra Bullock are, it's a very, very good, movie, and Dennis, what's his name in the background, the villain. The thing about that freeway though, it takes you right the way to LAX, the airport from wherever in fact you want to start downtown. But it flies over, they talk about surface streets and freeways, it flies over South Central, Compton, Inglewood, and all those deprived ghetto areas, though the word ghetto isn't used in LA. And over the 80s, they were hugely depressed. Now the 80s were a very good decade for me. Reagan came along. Yeah, he reduced tax for people like myself. My salary went up by a magnitude of three. I was earning six bigger sums, first time in my life. Any number of cars. It's what Mike Davis in Quartz City called sunshine and noir. The sunshine was shining on me, but the noir was all there. In Compton, there was a 50% literacy dysfunctional rate. It was It was, in fact, not quite back to slavery, because at least in slavery you got a good meal and you sort of actually had some kind of security. You were a property, so no one would blow you away just to see your body jerk. But, you know, every weekend there'd be 14 homicides, and most of them would be in that part of the city. And out of that came this music, which is protest music, which is... Now, there is a problem, which is attached to rap. One of the good things about rap is it is authentic. Now, obviously, people say poetry was very big in the 19th century. People like Tennyson, for instance, were bestsellers. Browning, American poets, Longfellow. But where did it go in the 20th century? Well, it went into popular music. But the thing about popular music is that it's performed. That's to say, you take a song like Rodgers and Hart, Lady is a Tramp, classic Frank Sinatra. Frank Sinatra didn't write it. He didn't even write sort of My Way. That was written by Paul Anka, who originally composed it in French. You've got this disjunction between the creation and the performance. Now, in rap, you don't. Tupac Shakur, that track which we watched, Changes. Tupac Shakur did his own stuff. The term which rappers use is playing it real. Now, the other terms they use are slanging, rhyming, and flow. It's almost exclusively black, but of course there is one very famous white rapper, Eminem, and the film 8 Mile Road actually sort of indicates the dynamic there, where in fact you have to improvise. There's a huge premium on creativity. That, it seems to me, is also the essence of poetry. I mean, Tennyson didn't write a poem and somebody else performed it. In fact, his is the first poet's voice which we've got. I mean, it's reading the Charge of the Light Brigade. So this authenticity, this playing it real factor, it seems to me, is something which makes rap peculiarly interesting. You see different performances and hear different performances of rap songs, and they're interestingly different. They are done for the time, for the moment. It's kind of instantaneous. It's a very powerful aspect of it. Now that, it seems to me, is one of the things which validates rap as something to which we should pay serious attention. The problem, however, is that one doesn't want to be what's called a wigger. I won't actually say. That's to say, there is in fact a critique. When Leroy Jones wrote his book, he called it Black Music for White America. Now, rap is largely consumed by young white people, or was. In fact, it's mutated now. It's been commodified. I think it's commercial. I think it's dead if it happens. But there is a moment when I think it's alive. Which is what I'm talking about now. But the thing is, there is this kind of problem that, in fact, the audience is so kind of separate. Now, you may or may not know, I think the greatest novel by an African-American writer, I'm not alone in thinking this, is Ralph Ellison's Invisible Man. Now, if you know Invisible Man began as a short story called Battle Royale, in which black athletes are blindfolded, put into a ring, and made to box each other for prizes, which turn out to be not prizes at all, to be phony, and they beat each other to death, effectively. Meanwhile, an audience of whites, and it's for their delectation that this spectacle is put on, watch this. It's called a battle royale, is the term. Now, you can see rap as being a bit like that. They were gangsters, but it's Quincy Jones, one of the truly great black musicians of the 20th century. His daughter, Khadida, was engaged to Tupac Shakur at the time that he was murdered. As Quincy Jones says, these guys are lousy gangsters. They're terrible. They're sort of... But they're terrific musicians. He saw them as in fact in direct line with the great blues singers, but that's by the way. But there is this problem that if you're if in fact you're white, looking at this kind of really kind of very sort of heavy spectacle of blacks, which the music in fact is super structural to, it does actually put you in an awkward position. It's quite interesting that this is a point that Ice-T makes, that the white population at large, by which he meant, you know, the kind of the homeland, got really alarmed about rap music when their daughters came home, the white daughters came home singing Two Live Crews, Me So Horny. And this guy just got them really sort of worked up. And there's some truth in that. The other problematic, of course, is in fact the, you know, the destructiveness, the kind of physical destructiveness. These people, you know, sort of the ones that didn't survive, like Dr. Dre, who's a or Jay-Z, or Sean John, the ones who didn't survive, in fact, were wiped out, and it is in fact difficult to, as it were, sort of, you know, really sort of get oneself in a position to have a kind of sensible response to that. I don't have one myself. I hate to think that I'm fascinated by it in the same way that I might be fascinated by a bullfight. Or by, in fact, you know, sort of perhaps there are some forms of contact sport in which there's a high level of injury, and there were real casualties. Now, it seems that Tupac Shakur is particularly he's the one, it seems to me, to be the, as it were, the writer I admire most. And one of the things which the rap artists did, which is very difficult to do, was to come to terms with death. You know, a lot of them actually died young. One of my favorite Tupac Shakur tracks is How Long Will They Mourn Me? I'll just read a bit of it out. You probably know it. It's what in fact is traditionally called a lament. All my homies drinking liquor, I won't try and do an American accent. All my homies drinking liquor, tears in everybody's eyes. Niggers cried to mourn a homie's homicide. But I can't cry, instead I'm just a shoulder. Damn, why they take another soldier? I load my clip before my eyes blurry. Don't worry, I'll get them suckers back before you're buried. Retaliate and pull a 187. Do real niggers get to go to heaven? It's a lament for one of his crew who's died. 187 is the LAPD code for murder. They're going to commit a revenge murder after they've grieved, poured the libation of liquor over the grave, and moved on. It is a music which has come to terms with death, and also a poetry which has as well. That elegiac element, I think, is very potent. It's very hard to find it in, you know, what one would think of as straight above ground poetry of the 1880s. The other thing which it seems that rap does, and the artist I admire most in this respect is Ice Cube, is that it tells stories. It is highly narrative. I'm thinking of particularly Ice Cube's double album called War and Peace. I don't think Tolstoy would be entirely sort of approving of it. But let me just read out one of the little narratives which is in that double album set. Again, you have to imagine that there is just this very, very kind of basic, rhythmic accompaniment. The music is not getting in the way of the words. It never does. And in this track, in this composition, Ice Cube, set in South Central LA, Ice Cube imagines himself as what he calls a vet. a veteran soldier, wounded, in fact disabled, crippled. My house shoes get wet from the dew on the grass, up early in the morning taking out the trash. Feeling like a loser, alcohol abuser, two youngsters roll up on a beach cruiser, a bicycle. One on the pedals, the other on the handlebars. You see this all the time in places like Santa Monica, by the way. Try to be ghetto stars, they said. Are you from the West Side? Is it so? They ask. I said, hell yeah, and who the fuck wanna know? In slow-mo, fo-fo, slugs face down in the mud, puddle full of blood, left for dead. The pain starts to spread now. I can't feel my legs. I meet doctor who at King Drew Medical Center as I enter ICU, intensive care unit. The King Drew Center is notorious. It's one of the hospitals which set up specifically for the black African-American population of Los Angeles. And it was very, very badly run. You went in there and chances are you would come out head first. He said, that's the doctor, the bullet hit a nerve that was vital. I said, I can't move my legs. He said, don't try to. Now this ain't the end, my friend, but you'll probably never walk again. I sit there motionless, holding this pain inside, contemplating suicide. At night and night, I jerk and jerk, but my dick don't work. It don't even hurt, damn. Now who'd ever thought a nigger rude as Ice Cube I'd be pissing through a tube. Fool, I'm a vet. Now, if that isn't poetry, what is it? And as I say, the music doesn't get in the way. The performance doesn't get in the way. It's done as recitative. It's talked, but talked in a way, talked in ways which I think peculiarly sort of gifted rap artists can manage. Now, this lecture is called Dr. Dre in the Classroom. Dr. Dre, as I say, is really actually gone on to be a very successful producer, Death Row Records. And it seems to me there is a place, it's very hard to see where you would put it. And I do have a, as it were, an ideal location for the study of this kind of, what did William Carlos Williams call the poem? A machine with words. And these seem to me to be machines with words. There is a place for it, and that is, it seems to me that at the moment, what is happening in our educational system is that we're moving away from the three-year program to the American four-year program. What is happening is increasingly students at UCL and elsewhere, but I notice it particularly at UCL, are doing an MA after they finish their BA or BSc. MSc, I think. Now, the advantage of the MA, particularly as I observe it in the English department here, is that it is a free-range area. There isn't, in fact, a prescriptive set of texts which have to be studied. It gives you, as it were. I mean, PhDs give you a lot more freedom, but the MA, in fact, which is dissertation-centered or dissertation-oriented, means that you can actually choose all sorts of interesting things. In the years up to the point at which I retired, I noticed that, in fact, increasingly students were drawn towards this kind of topic and treating it with great intelligence. Of course, if in fact you find yourself in an MA, as it were, grading or sort of examining situation, what you discover is that the person writing the dissertation knows much more than you do. So in fact, it is a kind of sort of, it's very interesting, there's a kind of power shift. And I think in fact that we should incorporate this kind of creative work into our sort of curriculum. Now, it would be controversial. It's less controversial in America, of course, particularly in areas where, in fact, there's a very, very strong African-American constituent. In fact, there are schools named after Tupac Shakur. Doubtless they'll name a prison after him at some point. But I'd be curious to know what Barack Obama thinks about rap. I mean, his taste in literature, he seems to be sort of fairly carefully sort of conservative. I think Michelle might be a bit more inclined to sympathy for this kind of activity. I should say, incidentally, one of the real problems of rap is that it is so misogynistic. There are very few, it seems to be, rap singers, women rap singers, Lil Kim, Queen Latifah, and they are grotesquely objectified. The other thing about rap is it seems to me that it's been reabsorbed into the large American commercial apparatus. There's a very interesting sort of track by Coolio, which, they love, on CDs, they love these kind of lead-ins, which quite often have little kind of, as it were, dramatic scenarios. And in one of Coolio's, the black rap singer goes in and blows away the record impresario. And in fact, rap did take over the means of production in classic Marxist ways. I mean, Death Row Records was a good example. And that is interesting. But there still remain these kind of problematics. And I say the attitude to women is difficult. The kind of rage is difficult to deal with, because quite often it's directed against people like me, rich, white, old people. Or at least well-off old people, who are white. And so, in fact, it's difficult. But I find it very moving when I drive along the freeways now in Los Angeles. And I still listen to Vibe and Power 105.1. It seems to me that they've still got something to do. What's interesting, though, is that they have clean versions. It's a very flexible art form. Anyway, the people at the back are making throat-slitting signals, which means that I've used up my time. And I think I'm told we have, if anyone wants to ask any questions, make any points, objections, we have a few minutes. Yes, please.
So people on the internet can hear you, so if you could just wait, this one here.
Thank you. Yes.
You sound wonderful.
A lot cleaner, right? Professor Sutherland, so you've been talking about how rap originated from blues.
Yeah.
It's all very, elemental music. What's your current opinion on how hip-hop is used now commercially in terms of its real value as music?
I'd be curious to know your views on that, actually.
I'm on your professional opinion. I mean, obviously everyone has their opinion, but...
Well, my opinion is that it's somehow, sort of been watered down and diluted. To some extent, it's been turned into a commodity. And I don't know, there is, I think, a kind of neutering of it. Is that your sense as well?
Yes, I believe the same thing.
Do you think that's inevitable, or do you think that always happens?
I think it comes with the education of the music. If people know where it's coming from and where the value actually lies, which is more in the storytelling, as you say, and actually in the rhythm rather than in the commercializing to make it sound like everything else, at the end of the day, people understand the real value of the music comes from real hip-hop.
I think rap is a kind of social music, and I mean, obviously there is a black president, and obviously I think things are marginally better now. In what were previously extremely sort of deprived areas, zones of American metropolitan environments. But I don't see any huge, I think the prison population of America is still predominantly, overwhelmingly, crime rates are still much higher in black communities than they are in, Beverly Hills. And so too with various other kind of indices like life shortening illness and so on, infant mortality. It seems like a long, that Tupac's changes are going to be a long time coming.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Has anyone up there?
There we go. I have to disagree. I think hip-hop's still a very dynamic art form. In fact, there was a mixtape released last week by an artist called Odyssey from the East Coast, and there's a song on there called Tangible Dream, and the message of the song is that the dreams that are held out to us are in fact, normally they're unachievable, but there are things that we can achieve, which is why it's called Tangible Dream. In fact, there are actually a lot of artists at the moment who are coming out, maybe this year, the last 18 months, who are really pushing hip-hop forward, and I think, well, I just wanted to make that point, really. I think that whilst Tupac and Biggie and the East and the West Coast, I think that dichotomy has kind of fallen away now, actually.
What was the last thing you said about East Coast, West Coast?
The dichotomy, the conflict has fallen away, and now everyone's just making the music that they want to hear.
I'm very interested in what you say, because you know much more about it than I do. But it seems to me that what you're describing is very much like the evolution of jazz, which has gone through various transitions, New Orleans, Chicago, swing, bebop, freeform. I don't know where it is now.
Especially what you're seeing these days is you're seeing producers who are also rappers, and you're seeing a lot more collaboration between different rappers and different producers. So instead of just seeing a group like NWA, who have Dr. Dre doing the production, then Ice Cube and Eazy-E doing the rapping, there will be rappers and producers floating around working on different collaborative projects, which is fantastic. I just want to make one more point.
Are the labels still black owned?
I think there's a lot more independent labels out there, but I don't think so, not anymore. I don't know that much about that side of
Where would you suggest one should start to, as it were, pick up the most interesting recent sort of...
Odyssey, O-D-D-I-S-E-E. The best out there at the moment.
Thank you very much. Everyone should write that on the back of their hands.
I have one over here.
So far the conversation's been dominated by discussions of American hip-hop, but in the last especially 10, 15 years, you've seen it emerge as a global art form. So not only has American hip-hop been taking on influences from, say, like the UK, where dubstep has become a lot bigger and involved in like hip-hop production, but South African hip-hop is a massive deal. It's been taking off in like Nigeria, and also as a way of storytelling aspects of the Arab Spring. So my question is, as we see American hip-hop, or some kinds of American hip-hop, especially I would say the stuff on major record labels, become more commercialized and watered down, do we have to move away from America in order to find something with more, I don't know, relevance or bite or authenticity? So I was thinking about black South African rappers like Spoke Mabotha and stuff. Move away from American stuff.
Who? I can't actually pick up your points about the regional evolution of this music outside America, but I am very struck by reggaeton, which is a fusion of Hispanic and hip hop. There's a whole kind of, I think, Cole radio station in Los Angeles, 96.5, which is dedicated to it. But unfortunately, my Spanish isn't good enough to pick up the lyrics. You know, and it seems to me that I don't know if you agree that what's important about rap, hip hop, R&B, whatever one calls it, is the fact that it is so it is so text based. It's so verbal, so oral, and not instrumental. Though in fact, you know, they can do wonderful things. I mean, give Jay-Z's group had that guy that does the does things with records and so on. They can simulate all sorts of wonderful things, but it doesn't get in the way of the words, you know, which are right at the front. But I take your point that in fact it, you know, seeds may have been sown internationally by it, but whether or not they will always be secondary to what was, you know, the kind of main, as it were, sort of source in America, I don't know.
I'm afraid we've run out of time for questions. Really sorry. I want to thank you all for coming. Thank you for your questions and discussions. But most of all, thank you.